I should also thank the forum that they've made my job so easy by in two ways. One, most of the things which I've put in the slides have already been discussed or they've been touched upon in the discussion which happened during the case discussion. I should thank Prabhu for that. I would like to give a brief introduction to what I was reflecting upon when I saw this topic being prescribed on me to present. Adult ADHD, is it a distinct entity? Now, if somebody asks me if schizophrenia is distinct from bipolar, it's a fairly easy question to answer, thinking that what is for the commonality, what is against the commonality between the two disorders. But when somebody asks a question, is it a distinct entity and there is no comparison, there is a vast area of field of psychiatry, medicine, which can be thought about and then decide whether adult ADHD is distinct. So the questions which came out of my own reflection was, is it that adult ADHD is distinct from childhood ADHD? Is it that adult ADHD is distinct from bipolar spectrum? Or is it a disorder which is distinct from other temperamental temperamental vulnerabilities? With this background, I have tried to prepare some of the presentation. But one disclaimer at the beginning is that from the turn of 1980s, there has been an exponential increase in the area of ADHD research. And from 1990s onwards, also in the field of adult ADHD. So the total publication of original articles is about 5,000. And I'm sure I have not been able to review all that for this presentation, but I'm flanked by researchers who are experts in the area, so I will seek their help during the course of today's presentation. Now, looking at to establish the fact that ADHD is distinct, something which is most important is, or what I thought to be most important is to know from history how ADHD came into existence. And if you look at the 1798 description by Sir Alexander Crichton, he was a physician who was, I think, Scottish. And then he went around Europe practicing in different clinics. And unlikely for a physician of that time that he found mental disorders to be of his interest. And in this, he published a series of books, or a three-volume set of books. And in his second book, on a specific topic called Disorders of Attention and Thereof, he writes this: the incapacity of attending with a necessary degree of constancy to any one object almost always arises from unnatural or morbid sensibility of the nerves, by which means this faculty is incessantly withdrawn from one impression to another. It may either be born with a person or it may be the effect of accidental diseases. When born with a person, it becomes evident at very early period of life and it has very bad effect. In as much as it renders him incapable of attending with constancy to any one object of education, but it seldom is in so great a degree as totally to impede all instruction, and what is fortunate, it is generally diminished with age. Now, if you look at this description from 1798, which is close to 220 years from now, the description seems, or some of the things which I have highlighted in red, are actually ones which also DSM-5, which codes ADHD today, talk about. So one of the reasons for putting this is to say portray my own interest in history, but the second more legitimate reason is that a legitimate description of an illness of ADHD was available at the same time when a description of schizophrenia, actually a legitimate description of an illness like schizophrenia, has started. So some of our doubts regarding, say, whether ADHD is a real biological illness or is it just a sociological phenomena, all these are put to dust after going through this description, which came 200 years ago. Now, the something which followed after that, and by another 50 years or so, again by Heinrich Hoffman, we were aware of two Hoffmans in the addiction field, Albert Hoffman for LSD and then Helix Hoffman for heroin. Whereas there is third Hoffman who actually looked into vulnerability rather than designing another drug of addiction. And he was a gifted physician in the sense that he was an obstetrician, but he got to practice in a psychiatric institute. And then he had this interesting habit of drawing pictures for children to calm them down. So this is a series of pictures which he drew, and this allegory is called Fidgety Phil. And if you look at some of the things which he has written, in fact, this got published in Lancet 1904, it's basically a story when the father and mother and the son are sitting for dinner, and then son's name is Philip, and then so father is asking him to be a gentleman, to sit still at once at the table, and then but Fidgety Phil, he won't sit still, he wriggles and giggles, and then he swings backwards and forwards. So he tilts the chair, tilts up in the he tilts up the chair, and then the naughty, restless child, the growing still more rude and wild. So this description is quite classical of what even we would think of a childhood diagnosis ADHD in this in today after close to 150 years of what when it was written. So again, historical descriptions of ADHD are quite very much there in literature, like descriptions of schizophrenia. Now, going a little more deeper, I already talked about Crichton and his description, but something which is more interesting, we were discussing about rheumatoid arthritis in this case. Still, who in 1902 actually proposed a formal diagnosis of ADHD, he talked about it as a disorder of moral control. And this is the same Still whom we talk about in Juvenile Rheumatoid Arthritis as Still's disease. So this description came around in 1902, and then between 1918 and 25 or 26, there was an encephalitis pandemic, followed by which there were a lot of children who were noted to have hyperkinetic disorder, and so ADHD became associated with an organic brain pathology. And then there was a description of this post-encephalitic hyperkinetic syndrome. And then they were noted to be, it was conceptualized as organic drivenness, and the lesion was linked to brainstem. And this was also the era when actually EEG came into existence, or EEG was extensively used in children with ADHD. And then, the site or the locus of ADHD has traveled all the way across the brain, from brainstem to diencephalon, and finally reaching the cortex. And now from cortex, as we are growing, it is going back to subcortical structures. So history is kind of repeating itself. Then it was in 1937 that therapeutic effect of stimulants on ADHD was diagnosed. This was again an accidental discovery, like most things in psychiatry, where Bradley was actually doing pneumoencephalograms for children. And there used to be severe headache post this procedure because of the spinal tap and loss of spinal fluid. So he used a drug called benzedrine in these people. And instead of actually healing their headache, what he noted was more than 50% of the children who received this drug started doing well academically, started doing achieving what they wanted to achieve. So this gave him this led to the discovery and a series of publications which he made on use of stimulants in ADHD, or symptoms like our hyperkinetic syndromes, which were then described. Then 1954, methylphenidate was discovered. Due to lack of time, I will not go to the story of that. That's also a very interesting story. One can read about how the name Ritalin came to existence. And then something which we'll skip through the rest of the points to the last one about Kornitsky, who proposed the first catecholamine hypothesis of ADHD, which was actually based on a misconception, because Kornitsky proposed that stimulants actually decrease the synthesis, turnover, as well as release of norepinephrine, whereas science has proved further on that it is the opposite effect, which it actually increases the release of catecholamines. However, even misplaced notions in science actually can lead to future developments. Now, looking at what happened to ADHD throughout DSM, why I'm going through all this is that the adult ADHD is as recent as just 25 years. It was a non-existent entity until then, because all throughout historical descriptions, ADHD was conceptualized as something which would, as one grows from childhood to adolescence to adulthood, it would subside and it would go away. DSM-2, it was called hyperkinetic reaction of childhood. This was again in reaction to some of the prevalent literature at that time following. There was a concept of minimal brain dysfunction, and this included things like ADHD, learning disabilities, which did not significantly impair one's living. So minimal brain dysfunction was changed to, or was modified to, hyperkinetic reaction of childhood. And then in DSM-3 in 1980, attention deficit disorder was named. Something interesting between DSM-3 and DSM-4 was that ADHD was initially thought to be a disorder of attention to be a primary, attention was thought to be the primary pathology in terms of cognitive domains, and then with or without hyperactivity was there. And then in DSM-3 revision, they made attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, giving hyperactivity an equal chance. And in DSM-4, they made it into three subtypes, predominantly inattentive, predominantly hyperactive, and combined. And so the diagnosis of ADHD, which came in DSM-3R, was retained. And this was when in 1994, there were a few longitudinal studies, which I'll briefly talk about, which happened, which looked at children from DSM-2, DSM-3 times, who were assessed over a course of 17 to 25 years. And one of the earliest longitudinal studies was published in 1993. And following the evidence which generated, inclusion of adult forms of the disorder came to our formal nosological classifications. Then DSM-4TR, there were no major changes. And we are seeing some positive change towards DSM-5, where we actually have reduced the symptoms threshold, keeping in mind some of the discussions which we had during the case discussion, that diagnosing ADHD in adults is slightly difficult, it is slightly different, we have to have different criteria, or the criteria have to be modified. With that in mind, though the criteria have not been modified, some of the positive changes which have happened is that the number of criteria have been reduced from a threshold of 6 per 9 in children to 5 per 9 for those who are 17 or older. And the onset of symptoms, which is earlier prescribed at before 7, has now been increased to up to the age of 12. There should be symptoms which are impairing one's functioning before the age of 12. And then more descriptive explanations, which also include some of the occupational and familial impairments which happen for adults, have also been added into the criteria in DSM-5. So this is some positive change which we have seen in the recent nosological classification. As I was talking about the longitudinal studies, so far there have been a total of close to 20 studies which have been longitudinally seen. Something which is of interest is that I'm sure it's difficult to read all that, but if we can read only those things in the bold, and coming to the last column, the persistence of ADHD is close to 40% in the studies which came in DSM-2 era, and it was about 52% in DSM-3 era. And beyond DSM-3 revised, when the attention deficit hyperkinetic disorder was conceptualized as a single entity, the persistence is close to 74% from childhood to adolescence. So on an average, we can say between 40 and 70% of the children who have ADHD go on to have impairments due to ADHD symptoms even during adulthood. However, and to briefly touch upon the epidemiology, in children, I've given the scores from DSM-5, but most researchers concur on this data about the prevalence rates. In children, it is between 5 to 8%, whereas in adults, it's about 2.5 to 3%. And the male-female ratio that we see during children, which is 2:1, changes to about 1.6:1 as one grows, which means the rates are just because the numbers of ADHD among male children is higher and their remit, the ratio comes down. And females, whenever they present with symptoms of ADHD, it is predominantly inattention domain which they complain of. However, there are controversies and there are some studies which do not support this view. Now, looking at something which we discussed during the case about how our ADHD in adults is different. One is that inattention subtype predominates. This was already alluded to. Hyperactivity, there is a study by Biederman, and the earlier table was also taken by the same study, Spencer and Biederman. It's an excellent review. One can go back. I've put the references in the last, at the end of the slide. So inattention subtype dominates the picture in whenever adults come. And some of the symptoms which we do not see in the diagnostic criteria, but which actually present, are procrastination, overreacting to frustration, insomnia, poor motivation, and time management difficulties. These are not explicitly there in the criteria, but to actually look for impairment in one's life, some of the questions which are relevant, as Sir was mentioning earlier, that how long is one able to keep himself in a job, how frequently he has changed the jobs, how easily he gets bored with a job, and what are the kinds of activities about which significant other in the family, which could be a spouse or a partner who is living together, finds difficulties in with the patient. So these are certain evidences which will give us the actual impairment due to ADHD symptoms which persist from childhood to adulthood. Now, the impairment can happen in multiple domains, as I said, in marital, familial, and occupational. Now, looking at biology, I should again give a disclaimer that I've highlighted it in very brief in a single slide, but there is extensive data on imaging and genetics of ADHD, which one should go back and read to. But because of the lack of time, I'll be summarizing it in this small in single slide. Now, the heritability estimates, which is the proportion of risk which could be attributable to one's genome, is about, I mean, in textbooks we read as a value of about 50 to 60%, but some of the recent analysis which have looked at this data say that the mean heritability is about 77%. And if you look at the candidate genes which have been studied, most of them, at least four of them, are surrounding dopamine, either dopamine receptor or dopamine uptake or dopamine synthesis. And there are a couple of serotonergic candidate genes which have also been looked at. And there is one synaptic vesicle related candidate gene. And whole genome-wide association studies have found 16p13 and 17p11 as the regions on the chromosome where there is high chance of finding ADHD genes. Now, if we divide the imaging data into structural, functional, and the synthesis of the two, I'll be at the end of the presentation, I'll be reviewing some of the data which has come out from our center. The structural imaging data has actually talked about volume loss in or volume reduction in frontal, cerebellar, and subcortical. These are the actually data which have come from adult patients with ADHD. And something which has been consistently found in functional MRI has been that anterior cingulate hypofunction based on tasks which look for selective attention. And then synthesis of these two would actually, there have been attempts to synthesize the information of the imaging studies, and which actually currently posit the possible etiology or the locus of the brain region as to frontosubcortical circuits, which mostly starts from dorsolateral prefrontal cortex to caudate putamen globus pallidus. But this is not as simple as this, because there have been other evidences which have come in which says orbitofrontal cortex also plays a great role if it is more of impulsivity related, whereas disorganization related impairments are because of dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. But this is a very simplistic presentation of the existing knowledge of imaging findings. Now, there are separate sessions for assessment and treatment which have been scheduled in the coming 2 weeks. So I'll not be going up at this in great detail, but something which Dr. Prabhu just showed during his case presentation is a simple scale which we have been routinely using in our clinical practice. If somebody scores more than 4 gray boxes in the first 6 questions, he is screened to have high likelihood of ADHD, and the subsequent 7 to 18, the questions from 7 to 18 can be used for further exploration of the symptoms. But once somebody screens positive with the 6 questions, the dictum for diagnosis is retrospectively established childhood ADHD, and then use the DSM-5 criteria in current cross-sectional functioning for diagnosis in at least 2 or more domains. The domains of functioning can be, for adults, could be, again, as I said, occupational, familial, or marital life, or even personal functioning. So this is the way. And something which I began my presentation with, that why is it a good topic to discuss ADHD as a distinct entity itself without comparing it with anything else? If you look at the comorbidity, almost all of the dimensions of psychiatric illnesses, except for maybe a pure psychotic dimension, have been found to be highly comorbid with attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. If you look at the mood disorders, there is bipolar, dysthymia, cyclothymia, and even major depressive. I mean, again, impulse control disorders like ODD, conduct, antisocial personality, borderline personality, and intermittent explosive, and then anxiety disorders, something which we may not expect. ADHD being conceptualized as something which comes from an externalizing syndrome, whereas anxiety disorders are more of a manifestation of an internalizing syndrome. However, if factor analytical studies have clearly proven that even externalizing and internalizing traits are themselves correlated, so there must be a super factor which is influencing the manifestation of externalizing and internalizing syndromes. Now, something which we see on the other side is the learning disabilities in childhood, which historically used to be minimal brain dysfunction, but currently is seen as a comorbidity of ADHD. And then most importantly for us, and to proceed the discussion from here on, why should a clinician who is treating persons with substance use disorders look at ADHD, or why should he be worried about ADHD? Because substance use disorders again come under the conception of externalizing syndrome along with ADHD, conduct disorder in childhood, antisocial disorder in the adults. So alcohol abuse and dependence and drug abuse and dependence become very are closely associated. Somebody raises a question at the end of our end of clinical case presentation about why should ADHD be studied, or if ADHD is studied, is it the nurture ADHD versus nature ADHD? We will go, I think those questions will be addressed during the course of this month's discussion. Now, treatment, there is again a separate module, but throughout the world, stimulants, despite the clinical the acquired clinical skills which have been and data published by our center, worldwide stimulants are the first choice of agents, followed by non-stimulants, which include desipramine, bupropion, atomoxetine, and even venlafaxine. There have been evidence for these things, but I'm sure the module which covers the treatment aspect in greater detail will look into this as will give us greater insight into this aspect. Now, as I talked about the comorbidity of ADHD and substance use disorder, looking at some of the international data on prevalence of substance ADHD in patients with substance use disorder, this is a multi-center a meta-analysis and a meta-regression analysis, which found at least 23.1% of all patients with substance use disorder meet criteria for ADHD, which is greater than 1 in 5 of the patients whom we see. The scores, but this data is based on studies which used strict DSM diagnostic criteria. But if we look at more of clinical questionnaires, or if we look at the impairments, and if we also factor in the reports from the significant other who is currently living with the adult, the rates might be much, much higher than that. And something of interest which emerged out of this study is that the cocaine dependence was found to be less, having a lesser association compared to things like alcohol or opiate dependence. Again, something which came in our discussion, despite cocaine being a stimulant and or something which works very close, like similarly to a stimulant, there's a lesser association between ADHD and our cocaine dependent people having ADHD. Now, asking the same question other way around, do children with attention deficit hyperactivity disorder develop substance use disorder in future? Again, this is a meta-analysis, and the odds ratio, though might seem modest, is significant. Excuse me for not putting the confidence intervals. The alcohol use disorders was higher about 1.35 times, and nicotine use disorder was about 2.36 times. And something which has emerged in early other evidences is that as we go from substances like alcohol and nicotine towards more hard substances, this odds ratio is going to go even higher. Now correlates of co-occurring ADHD in drug-dependent subjects, prevalence and features of substance dependence in psychiatric. This study actually found a slightly lower prevalence of about 5.8%, but this was not a meta-analytical study. It was a single center study. The 5.8%, but still, when it was compared to the non-substance use non-substance use disorder population of the same center, the rates were much lower for the non-substance use disorder group compared to the substance use disorder group. And again, a 10-country multi-site study found a prevalence varying between 5.4% to 31%. I mean, why I have put some of these studies also is that though one meta-analysis found a prevalence of about 23%, when things are looked at from different countries, the prevalence of ADHD has been found to be varying, which also establishes another reason for why such studies should be carried out in individual populations like India, even in India, like in southern and northern India, how it could be different. And because this was a study in 5.4% was found from Hungary, whereas 31% was found from an American setting. So there are geographical differences which may not be completely explained by biological factors, but we need to have a closer look at this aspect. Now, looking at some of the data from our own center, this is something which is in press. We did not use the DSM-5 or we did not use the ICD criteria for diagnosis, but we just put ASRS as a tool and then looked for likely and highly likely ADHD. Unlike the scale which was shown earlier, the ASRS scale which was shown earlier, there was another version which could actually give scores for inattention subtype and hyperactivity impulsivity subtype. And we found that 56% in our population, our clinical sample, screened for likely ADHD, but 22% screen for highly likely ADHD. But if we actually put the clinical criteria, the figure might fall somewhere in between 22% and 56%. The data from the same study, we were actually interested in looking at early onset and late onset. This is something which has been again clearly established in the scientific literature of addiction about how early onset substance use, how ADHD, childhood ADHD predisposes to early onset or adolescent onset substance use disorders. And the total sample was 240. These are some of the demographic parameters. But if you look at the fourth row, about 59% in the early onset, whereas only about 35% in the late onset group screen for likely ADHD. Looking at the more narrow criteria for highly likely ADHD, 23% in early onset group and 12.9% in the late onset group screen positive for highly likely ADHD. Though this is not statistically significant, something which I would want to bring to your notice is that because these are based on total scores of inattention and hyperactivity subtype. As we know, as we grow older, the hyperactivity component comes down. And if you look at the inattention scores, looking at from a numerical variable perspective, you look at the inattention scores. Inattention score was significantly higher in the early onset group compared to the late onset group in the first row, which we can see. Whereas the same was not true for hyperactivity impulsivity score. Again, total score was or tended towards statistical significance. And even, And some of the imaging data which has emerged from our centers are. One study looked at corpus callosum volume abnormalities, and the hypothesis was to look at whether greater excising behaviors in subjects would correlate with corpus callosum volume abnormality, and reduced size of total corpus callosum volume and genu and isthmus in high risk subjects compared to low risk subjects. The subjects were assessed on a scale which actually it was not ASRS which was used. It actually looks at hyperactivity, impulsivity, inattention, and conduct symptoms as four domains, and the total externalizing score is computed. And so externalizing score actually negatively correlated with the size, which meant those who were at lower risk had a greater volume of corpus callosum, which suggests that the greater connectivity or better connectivity in the brains between the hemispheres. Now, again, looking at gray matter volume abnormalities and externalizing symptoms, smaller volumes of superior frontal, cingulate, parahippocampal gyri, amygdala and thalamus and cerebellum was found in people who had high risk. And externalizing scores again negatively correlated with the volume abnormality or total volume. And this was a TMS study. Again, here we can note that cortical silent period negatively correlated with externalizing symptom score. Not just about the biological changes which has been seen, we have some data which has established that treating comorbid ADHD in patients with substance use disorder improves outcomes. Now, out of a screened sample of about 262, 18 were treated with atomoxetine, and at the end of the study, externalizing symptom score was noted to be reduced. There was longer period of abstinence and better quality of life among people who had comorbid ADHD and who were treated. Here, the ADHD or externalizing syndrome was actually established using the ASRS scale, which I earlier showed. To make concluding remarks, there is substantial evidence based to support the existence of an entity of adult ADHD. The current consensus is that it is a continuum of childhood ADHD. ADHD falls under the broader rubric of externalizing syndrome, and childhood ADHD poses significant risk for adolescent and adult substance use disorders. And preliminary evidence also supports the treatment of comorbid ADHD in patients with substance use disorder improves outcomes. These are some of the references. There are a few which are excellent reviews in the area of adult ADHD, one by Spencer and Biederman, which I would recommend one can go through for greater interest. And if somebody is actually interested in history, one should read this article by Lange, which is the top. Yeah. Thank you.